Hello everybody, this is Jörg Lissmann once again with another reading of Rulers of Evil, Chapter 20, American Graffiti, it is called. I'll start right away here, because this is a very long chapter, probably done in two parts. Let's see how far we get today. Chapter 20, American Graffiti of Rulers of Evil by F. Tupper Saucy. There is a universal legal tradition that requires acts of a governmental authority to be marked by a seal. Otherwise, the acts are not authentic. Typically, a seal discloses the character of the authority it represents by means of an image which can be, and usually is, amplified by some sentence, phrase, or word. The first seal of the United States of America, designed to authenticate all governmental actions under the Declaration of Independence, was presented to Congress in August 1776. Created by an official committee consisting of Benjamin Franklin, John Adams, and Thomas Jefferson, the seal illustrates an event based on Exodus 14, verses 19 through 27. It is a cameo of Moses leading the Israelites through the parted waters while a chariot-bound Pharaoh, wielding a sword and wearing the crown of tyranny, perishes in the maelstrom. Framing the picture are the words, quote, "Rebellion to tyrants is obedience to God." Unquote. Now, when I first became aware of this seal many years ago, I thought it demonstrated how intensely biblical was the faith of the founding fathers. Yeah, how intensely biblical was the faith of the founding fathers. But once I began discerning the hidden makers of American naturalism, my thinking changed radically. And I think that is also something my listeners experience while getting through this book. This is exactly what everybody experiences when studying omitted history. When you take a look at many of my videos and also at the website of granddesignexposed.com, where we took a lot of information out of, you can learn of the hidden founding fathers, not only of what Chris Pinto called in his documentary The Hidden Face of the Founding Fathers, but you learn about the hidden founding fathers, as we've learned a lot on the Carrolls, which are the hidden founding fathers here in the book reading, and the religion they hid behind, that is Romanism, as you probably know by now. You will learn, as also in this book pointed out, that the government of the United States of America from the get-go was universal, Catholic, sun-worshipping, Babylonian, Satanism, Luciferianism. The author continues, "I now see this seal, despite the biblical glow of the committee that designed it, as the profession of an intensely Roman Catholic faith. For there is a great disparity between biblical faith and Roman Catholic faith. Indeed, this disparity was the crux of the Protestantism which Pope Paul III commissioned the Society of Jesus to extirpate." Now, I don't want to get too fast over this last paragraph. I hope that you really understood very well what Tupper Saucy wrote here, in absolute truth, what he wrote here. "I now see this seal, despite the biblical glow of the committee that designed it, as the profession of an intensely Roman Catholic faith, for there is a great disparity between biblical faith and Roman Catholic faith, or in other words, there is a great disparity between Christianity and Roman Catholics." That's also a way you can read it, and that's the way I think that you have to read it. "Indeed, this disparity was the crux of the Protestantism which Pope Paul III commissioned the Society of Jesus to extirpate." That's why he called into living the Society of Jesus, exactly. Now, the author continues to say that biblical faith regards the Bible alone, sola scriptura, apart from any other source, to be a sufficient and infallible rule of life in the Bible's own words, as we can read in 2 Timothy 3, verse 16 and 17, quote, "All scripture is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly truly furnished unto all good works. End quote. Roman Catholic faith, on the other hand, while agreeing that the Bible is God-breathed, considers the scripture neither infallible nor sufficient in itself as a rule of life, unless so interpreted by the magisterium, which is the authority of the Church, the teaching authority of the Church, and so pronounced by the infallible Pope. I'm going to give you a few quotations here that will support what Trapasorsi says here. For example, when we look up the Catholic Encyclopedia, volume 12, page 496, it reads, "The supremacy of the Bible as source of faith is unhistorical, illogical, fatal to the virtue of faith, and destructive of unity. It is unhistorical." Unquote. And there's another quote I want to read to you that comes from the Roman Catholic Confessions for Protestants, Oath, Article 11. "We confess that the Pope has power of changing Scripture and of adding to it and taking from it according to his will." Unquote. Now, this Roman Catholic Confessions for Protestants oath is something that I will address in one of my next videos, because it is something that I've learned when I listened very closely and intensely to what's that guy called? Ian Paisley, and his reading on the Jesuits, where I have a video on. And he mentioned these Roman Catholic Confessions for Protestants oath, and I looked that up, and all these 23 points we will go through in another video, and I can tell you it is very interesting, and you will not, you don't want to miss that, I'm quite sure. But okay, the author continues, "At Paul III's Council of Trent between 1545 and 1563, which we have learned was closely supervised over its 18 years of existence by the Jesuits, it was even inaugurated by the Jesuits, it was decreed that the magisterium, quote, receives and venerates with a feeling of piety and reverence all the books of the Old and New Testaments, also the traditions, whether they relate to faith or morals, as having been dictated either orally by Christ or by the Holy Ghost, and preserved in the Catholic Church in unbroken succession," unquote. Over the centuries, Roman Catholic faith in Scripture, as modified by tradition, as pronounced by the magisterium and Pope, has bound millions of consciences to a thousand doctrines not found in Scripture, and either unknown or rejected by the apostles and early Christian fathers. The 1776 seal agrees with Roman Catholic teaching as much as it disagrees with the Bible. Whereas the caption, quote, "Rebellion to tyrants is obedience to God," is found nowhere in Scripture, it is the cornerstone of Bellarminian liberation theology. And therefore I ask you, look up who Bellarmine was, Cardinal Bellarmine, one of the most venerated Jesuits in their history. "The Bible never condones rebellion, not even rebellion to those tyrants under whom God's own people, the Israelites, were obliged to suffer continuously. When Scripture mentions rebellion, it is almost always referring to the disobedience of the Israelites toward their God, Yahweh. The 17th chapter of Proverbs teaches that, quote, the evil man seeks rebellion." And we can read the whole quote here. "An evil man seeketh only rebellion. Therefore a cruel messenger shall be sent against him," as the complete quote from 1 Samuel from Proverbs is reading. And 1 Samuel 15:23 admonishes that rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. The God of Scripture cannot be obeyed by evil doing and witchcraft. He will not be honored in the breach. However, sacred tradition authorizes anything in the service of Rome. Cum finis est licitus, etiam media sunt licita, meaning the end justifies the means. Sacred tradition authorizes anything in the service of Rome. The end justifies the means. Cum finis est licitus, etiam media sunt licita. Depicting rebellion as a salvational act, the 1776 seal further harmonizes with the Magisterium on how the sinful soul of man is saved from eternal punishment. The Magisterium concurs with the Bible that salvation is the free gift of God's grace, but adds the non-scriptural teaching that salvation can be lost if good works are not performed through the quote-unquote sacred channels of baptism, confession, and the Mass. Scripture, and more specifically Ephesians 2 verses 8 through 10, says that Jesus Christ does not share his saviorhood with anyone or anything. Quote, "For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." Unquote. Yet the Magisterium says that Christ is no savior without the sinner's cooperation with the church and its traditions. In fact, Scripture's recount of the Exodus shows the departure from Egypt not to be a rebellion at all. When called by Yahweh to represent Israel before Pharaoh, Moses pled himself incapable, uninformed, unauthorized, ineloquent, unadapted, unproven, and uncredentialed, hardly the audacious mindset of a rebel, of a great rebel leader. Now, all these points Tapper Saucy sums up here are to be found in the Bible. Moses pled himself incapable, as we can read in Exodus 3:11. And it reads, "And Moses said unto God, Who am I, that I should go unto Pharaoh, and that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt?" He was uninformed, as we read in Exodus 3:13. Quote, "And Moses said unto God, Behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, The God of your fathers has sent me unto you, and they shall say to me, What is his name? What shall I say unto them?" He was not only uninformed, as we just read, but also unauthorized. He quotes in Exodus 4, verse 1, quote, "When Moses answered and said, But behold, they will not believe me, nor hearken unto my voice, for they will say, The Lord hath not appeared unto thee." He was ineloquent, as he states himself in Exodus 4, verse 10. "And Moses said unto the Lord, O my Lord, I am not eloquent, neither hitherto, nor since thou hast spoken of thy, unto thy servant, but I am slow of speech and of a slow tongue." He was unadapted, as we can read in Exodus 4, 13. Quote, "And he said, O my Lord, send, I pray thee, by the hand of him who thou wilt send." He was even unproven, as we can read in Exodus 5:23, quote, "For since I came to Pharaoh to speak in thy name, he hath done evil to this people, neither hast thou delivered thy people at all." And uncredentialed, as we can read in Exodus 6, verse 12, "And Moses spake before the Lord, saying, Behold, the children of Israel have not hearkened unto me. How then shall Pharaoh hear me, who am of uncircumcised lips?" So, the scripture's account of Exodus shows the departure from Egypt not to be a rebellion. We see what Moses was kind of a person. He pled himself incapable, uninformed, unauthorized, ineloquent, unadapted, unproven, uncredentialed. I think, really, what Tapper Saucy's point was going to make, this is hardly what an audacious mindset for a great rebel leader should be. So what Moses led was no rebellion, but a sociological deliverance for which Yahweh alone claimed responsibility. Quote, "Come now, therefore, and I will send you to Pharaoh, so that you can bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. And I will stretch out my hand and smite Egypt with all my wonders which I will do in the midst thereof. And after that, he will let you go." Unquote. This comes from Exodus 3, verse 10 and 20. If Adams, Franklin, and Jefferson wished the 1776 seal to express the true teaching of Scripture, they might have written, quote, Yahweh removes tyrants for his faithful. Meaning that if the founding of the United States of America in 1776 really would have been an act of Protestantism, of biblical founding that nation, it shouldn't read rebellion to tyrants is obedience to God, but it better could have read Yahweh removes tyrants for his faithful. Man is not made for rebellion. Man is there to obey God in the first place. Anyway, the author continues, but even with the biblically correct motto, the seal fails the biblical standard. For it is, after all, a seal, authority represented by a graven image. And what does the Bible teach about graven images? We are just going to learn about that. Although the use of seals and images is one of the Roman Catholicism's proudest sacred traditions, Scripture prohibits it. The only Israelite shown to rule with a seal is King Ahab, who, quote, did evil in the sight of the Lord above all that were before him, as we can read in 1 Kings 16, verse 30. Ahab's seal, apparently appropriated from ancient pagan tradition, was employed by his wife, the quintessentially wicked Jezebel, to commit fraud and murder, as we can read in 1 Kings 21, 8 through 16. And I'm going to read that here because this is a part that you really should understand before we go any further in this book. So from 1 Kings 8 through 16, it reads, so she wrote letters in Ahab's name and sealed them with his seal, and sent the letters unto the elders and to the nobles that were in his city, dwelling with Naboth. And she wrote in the letter, saying, proclaim a fast, and set Naboth on high among the people. And set two men, sons of Belial, before him to bear witness against him, saying, thou didst blaspheme God and the king, and then carry out and stone him, that he may die. And the men of his city, even the elders and the nobles, who were the inhabitants in his city, did as Jezebel had sent unto them, and as it was written in the letters which she had sent unto them. They proclaimed the fast, and set Naboth on high among the people. And there came in two men, children of Belial, and sat before him. And the men of Belial witnessed against him, even against Naboth, in the presence of the people, saying, Naboth did blaspheme God and the king. Then they carried him forth out of the city, and stoned him with stones, that he died. Then they sent to Jezebel, saying, Naboth is stoned, and is dead. And it came to pass, when Jezebel heard that Naboth was stoned and was dead, that Jezebel said to Ahab, arise, take possession of the vineyard of Naboth the Jezreelite, which he refused to give thee for money, for Naboth is not alive, but dead. And it came to pass, when Ahab heard that Naboth was dead, that Ahab rose up to go down to the vineyard of Naboth the Jezreelite to take possession of it. Quite an example for misusing of a seal, isn't it? Now, Scripture warns of an unlimited potential for evil inherent in graven image seals. The apostles of Christ understood this principle well. They saw the Pharisees demand Jesus show them a token of his authority, and what Jesus showed them was not an image of, but Scripture, the book of Jonah, as we can read in Matthew 12, 39 and first following. Quote, but he answered and said unto them, an evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, and there shall no sign be given to it, but the sign of the prophet Jonas. For as Jonas was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh shall rise in judgment with this generation and shall condemn it, because they repented at the preaching of Jonas, and behold, a greater than Jonas is here. Unquote. Now Paul the apostle had no seal except the people he'd evangelized, as we can read in 1 Corinthians chapter 9 verse 2. Quote, if I be not an apostle unto others, yet doubtless I am to you, "For the seal of mine apostleship are ye in the Lord." Unquote. Indeed, the seal of the body of Christ is represented in Scripture not by mitre and crossed key of the Holy See, or the doves, flames, Bibles, bear crosses, and sunbursts of the Protestant denominations, but by Scripture alone, as we can read in 2 Timothy 2, verse 19. Quote, "Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his. And let every one that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity." Unquote. The early Christian leaders whose faith is historically regarded as the best informed of any generations, well, of course, because they were so close to the time of Christ's living, they had seen the real truth, they had even seen the real Messiah. The early Christian leaders whose faith is historically regarded as the best informed of any generations rigorously opposed the making of images or likeness of any kind. Scripture had taught them well that Yahweh's people always suffered terrible calamity whenever they violated the commandment not to identify themselves with, of their gods with, quote-unquote, any graven images or any likeness of anything, as we can read in Exodus 20, verse 4. Edwin Bevan's Holy Images, An Inquiry into Idolatry and Image Worship in Ancient Paganism and in Christianity, cites three important early churchmen who forbade images. The first is Clement of Alexandria, and he taught that images were, quote-unquote, not true, and were forbidden by Yahweh, quote, "in order that we might not direct our attention to sensible objects, but might proceed to the intelligible, unquote. The second was Origen. An Origen held that images, quote, "drag the soul down instead of directing the mind to a divine invisible reality," unquote. And third, we have Tertullian, who instructed the servants of God to avoid every form of imagery, even secular art. Indeed, as Bevan points out, Christians of the first and second centuries placed visual artists in a class with harlots, drunkards, brothel keepers, and actors. Now, what does that do in our day-to-day we live in? Huh? Christians of the first and second centuries placed visual artists in a class with harlots, drunkards, brothel keepers, and actors. Beware of anything and everything coming out of so-called Hollywood. The author continues, but for thousands of years Mediterranean cultures had been receiving their religious and political information from myths narrated by visual art. Paulinus, Bishop of Nola, said of his congregations, quote, "they are not devoid of religion, but not able to read," unquote. This was Paulinus' excuse for beseeching the Bishop of Rome to permit him to teach with graven images. Paulinus had forgotten, or perhaps had never learned, that the basis of the Gospel of Christ was above all literary. Else why had its author prohibited graphic likeness? Knowing this, the apostles devoted a large part of the evangelical process to spreading literacy. Blessed is he who reads, as we read, as we read in Revelation 1, verse 3, quote, "Blessed is he that readeth, and he that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand," unquote. To keep the people from reading, as the papacy did through all the dark ages, which were dark not only because people didn't have the gospel, didn't have the Bible, but also because they had no knowledge, because they had no education, they had no literacy, they couldn't read books. That's why you had oral traditions. You know, the people in the land, they gave all their history, family history and history of what happened and everything, they gave that orally because they could not read and they could not write. And that is why in the Bible, writing reading literacy is so much held up, because you have to read, you have to read to understand the Word of God, because the Word of God is written in the King James 1611 Bible. So when you can't read, you cannot communicate with God. But then you have to rely on people, most of the times priests, and they teach not the true Word of God, but they teach the teachings of man, as we know by the papacy. But okay, the author continues, even so, the Apostle Peter foresaw the time of Paulinus, Bishop of Nola, a time when, quote, false teachers among you shall bring in damnable heresies and denying the Lord, as we can read in 2 Peter 2, verse 1. What more damnable heresy could there be than depicting a God who condemns images with an image? What more damnable heresy could there be than depicting a God who condemns images with an image? Think about that. Could such a God even be depictable by an image? Wouldn't an image purporting to be him have to be in reality, by sheer force of logic, the image of another God? And what did God say about that? There are no other gods beside him, right? The Apostle Paul, aware of the compelling nature of images and their definitive incapacity to teach Jesus and the gospel, warned the Corinthians how easily a false teacher could lead them to, quote, another Jesus, another gospel, as we can read in 2 Corinthians 11, verse 4. The time was very close, Paul knew, when Christians, quote, will not endure sound doctrine, but will heap to themselves teachers who will switch them from the truth to myths, as we can confirm by reading 2 Timothy 4, verse 3 and 4. And what are graven images but the very grammar of myth? You know, letters have grammar when you write them. Symbols have that too. And all these images are the very grammar of the myths and of the symbols. What are graven images but the very grammar of myths? The switch began noticeably happening in the 3rd century, when teachers like Paulinus of Nola began instructing from pictures, for which Paulinus was canonized by the Roman Catholic Church, by the way. Of course, he used images to teach so-called the Word, or what he called the Word. That is contrary to Scripture, therefore the Roman Catholic Church, of course, has to make him a saint. He was canonized. With Constantine, a century later, as we've seen, a powerful new quote-unquote Christian visual language developed. Old mythic icons were renamed to fit Bible stories, and an iconic Christianity was spread through pagan images processed by missionary adaptation. Now, go back to the second chapter of the book to understand what missionary adaptation means. Okay? What the new converts were not taught is that Scripture categorically rejects such attempts to iconize its contents, and that therefore, again by sheer force of logic, the likeness upon whom they reverently gazed were no more than the gods and goddesses originally pictured, other gods of other gospels. Archaeology traces these gods and their gospels back to the very earliest Babylonian cathedrals. Now, for a better understanding of this, I advise you to read Alexander Hislop's The Two Babylons, or you can also follow my reading of the Babylon Mystery Religion that I do on Juggler 66 channel, which is actually kind of a summary of Hislop's work. Hislop's work is three or four kind as big as Babylon Mystery Religion, but when you understand Babylon Mystery Religion, you already have a very good grasp of how the archaeology traces these gods and gospels back to the Babylonian cathedrals, and where the connection between Babylon from then and Rome, Babylon from today, is. Okay? It was in these cathedrals, erected nearly 4,000 years before the Christian era, that the Roman Catholic sacred iconographic tradition was born. We shall explore this subject in some detail in the forthcoming chapter. So, I'm already giving you a teaser to keep listening to chapter 21 at least when I'm done with chapter 20. The author continues on the page 208. Congress refused to adapt the 1776 seal. We may never know why. There is no record of any debate, only the notation that the seal was ordered to lay, quote-unquote, on the table. 5 years later, in the summer of 1781, a fleet of 25 French war vessels arrived at Chesapeake Bay, with more than 20,000 soldiers accompanied by 90 Roman Catholic chaplains and God only knows how many secularized Jesuits. Secularized Jesuits, the result of Lorenzo Ricci's planned, quote-unquote, abolishing of the Jesuit order. So the wolves now not only wear sheep's clothing, but any form of disguise one can imagine. They came in as lawyers, they came in as teachers, they came in as every profession they wanted to, and you could not tell whether Jesuits or not, because the Jesuits were officially forbidden. They had perfectly hidden behind the secular garments they hid behind. A month later, the British Army surrendered to General Washington at Yorktown. The legend-spinning Visible War was over at last. Now, this is a very important sentence. The legend-spinning Visible War was over at last. Jesuit theater, like all the wars since the Jesuits' rule. They are all theater, just played in front of us. The Visible War was over. In June 1782, Benjamin Franklin and John Adams were meeting in Paris to perfect a treaty with envoys of the newly elected British Prime Minister, Robert Petty. Now, we recall Robert Petty, Lord Shelburne, the ubiquitous Jesuit of Berkeley Square, who teamed with Lord Bute to conclude the French and Indian Wars in terms that had made the Revolution inevitable. And who was the man behind that? Okay, you know the answer as well as I do. Franklin and Adams found themselves approaching the negotiating table without a national seal. Nothing they might do on behalf of the United States could be valid without a seal. This was the exigency that moved Congress to adopt on June 28 the seal designed by Charles Thomson and William Barton. The Great Seal is, quote-unquote, written in Kabbalah. That style of allegorical communication composed of seemingly unrelated symbols, numerals, and phrases. A piece in Le Charivari, number 18 in Paris 1973, published, discussing certain symbolic motifs used by the enlightened French artist Nicolas Poussin, explains the practical advantage of Kabbalistic works. Quote, "A single word suffices to illumine connections which the multitude cannot grasp. Such works are available to everyone, but their significance addresses itself to an elite. Above and beyond the masses, sender and receiver understand each other." Yeah, and the mess is left in the dark. End quote, by the way. Kabbalah goes beyond mere secret communication. Supposedly it thrusts the sender, quote, into direct contact with the living powers and forces of the universe, and through them with the eternal source of all manifestation, unquote, explains Henrietta Bernstein in her Kabbalah Primer. Quote, "In other words, you make contact with God," unquote. With what God do you make contact when you use the Kabbalah? I am quite sure this is not the God of the Bible who forbids all these things. But, Henrietta Bernstein says, you make contact with God. To a Kabbalistic Gnostic Illuminatus whose special knowledge has liberated him from the clutch of matter and is speeding him toward the pure light of godliness, Kabbalah is, quote, "the royal art, a closed body of knowledge sacred to the elect." Unquote. Since the Great Seal is written in the language of Kabbalah, it appears to be a veritable Gnostic constitution. In terms well known to initiates and God Almighty, it sets forth the origin, nature, purpose, and plan of American government. Of course, as Charles Thompson and Manly P. Hall have intimated, the initiates will never disclose to outsiders the meaning of the seal's elements. But God Almighty is not so aloof. He does not resist inquiries, nor is he a respecter of persons. Contrary to the Kabbalist's boasts of privileged access, Scripture promises more light to any mind that seeks it from God in person. Shining that light on commonly available histories of rulers and religions, anyone can trace the seal's elements back to their ancient origins, and in the end knows as much as, if not more than, the Gnostics. This is what we are going to be busy with the next part in this chapter. On the front or obverse side of the seal, we find an eagle clutching an olive branch and 13 arrows with a banner in his beak inscribed with the motto E Pluribus Unum, that stands for Of Many One. The earliest images of sacred eagles have been found in that region of present-day Iraq, once known as Babylon. The eagle was identified with Babylonian sky god Anu. When Anu entered sacred Roman iconography as Jupiter, the eagle was still his mascot. For the more than 2,000 years since the death of Rome's first emperor, Julius Caesar, and we are going to back to going a little bit more deep into Julius Caesar later on in this chapter, but you have to understand Julius Caesar was the first Roman emperor who also bare the title Pontifex Maximus, which is the official title of the Pope today. For the more than 2,000 years since the death of Rome's first emperor Julius Caesar, Jupiter's eagle has signified Rome's imperial power. Imperial meaning the right of the Caesars to make laws and enforce them. In many a church, Roman Catholic and Protestant alike, the Bible from which lessons are publicly read rests on a hardwood lectern carved in the shape of a magnificent eagle. Yet, in the pages of this very Bible, God forbids carved images of eagles. We can read that in Leviticus 11, verse 13. What then does the eagle signify, if not a power indifferent to Scripture? The brilliant cloud hovering over the eagle's head in the Great Seal is the Aegis. The Aegis is a goatskin, and we have already examined how Scripture equates the goat with worldly power and separation from God. You know, we have the sheep on the right and the goats to the left of God in heaven. Yeah? When Jupiter was a baby, he was nursed by a she-goat named Amalthea. The priestly artists often portrayed the adult Jupiter as a satyr, having a man's body with the horns, hair, and legs of a goat. When Amalthea died, Jupiter made the Aegis out of her hide. The Aegis of the Great Seal glorifies 13 five-pointed stars, or pentagrams. Each pentagram represents an original state. In Gnostic symbology, the pentagram is identified with Jupiter's wife, Venus. There is a natural reason for this. A dedicated observer from a fixed location over an 8-year period will discern that the planet Venus travels a unique celestial pathway that exactly describes a pentagram. Carl Jungmann, in Dictionary of Symbols, has written, quote, "As the orbit of Venus is closer to the Sun than the Earth's position, she is never seen more than 48 degrees from the Sun. During a period of 247 days, Venus is visible as the evening star, that is, within 48 degrees or less of the Sun after the Sun has set. Then Venus comes too close to the Sun for us to see her. She remains invisible for 14 days, then reappears as the morning star, or eastern star, immediately before the sun rises in the east. For 245 days, we can see Venus each morning at dawn before she again disappears into the sun's light by getting too close to the sun. Venus is now invisible for 78 days. On the 79th evening, she appears again in the west immediately after the setting sun. How she is in the evening star once more. If one knows the ecliptic, that is, the great circle of the celestial sphere, that is the apparent path of the sun among the stars, and can pinpoint the present position of the planets in relation to the constellation of fixed stars in the zodiac, one can mark the exact place in the 360 degrees of the zodiac where the morning star first appears shortly before the sunrise after a period of invisibility. If we do this, wait for the morning star to appear again 584 days later, the synodic orbital time of Venus, and mark its position in the zodiac, and then repeat this process until we have five positions of Venus as the morning star, we will find that exactly 8 years plus 1 day have passed. If we then draw a line from the first point marked to the second point marked, then to a third, and so on, we end up with a pentagram. Only Venus possesses the five-pointed star sign. Not one of the innumerable stars above us can recreate this by its own orbit. And remind you what the pentagram stands for, right? Remember Isaiah 14? Satan, Lucifer's rebellion in heaven? I will exalt myself above the stars of God. I will sit in the congregation. I will be like the Most High. Five eyes, the pentagram. And here you got it in Kabbalistic meanings. And even if you didn't understand it, it's not that bad, you know, because all this Kabbalistic is unbiblical. It is not for us real Bible-believing Christians to know or to fully understand. After all, don't forget, God is still in control. Whatever signs they use, you know. Anyway, on the bottom of page 211, the author continues. Charles Thomson, the great seals co-designer, led a group of dedicated observers of Venus. The first coordinated scientific experiment of the American Philosophical Society, the Club Thomson, founded for politically radical young professionals, focused on Venus's celestial pathway. On the evening of June 3, 1769, with colleagues stationed at three sites in Pennsylvania and Delaware, Thomson and five others watched from the public observatory on State House Square in Philadelphia an eclipse caused by, quote, the transit of Venus across the sun, unquote. The goddess Venus, as we've seen, was observed by missionary adaptation into the Roman Catholic sacred tradition as the Virgin Mary. The adeptors even ascribed to Mary the Venusian epithet Queen of Heaven, a title never ascribed to Mary in the Bible. Queen of Heaven in Scripture names only one personage, and that is Ishtar, the Babylonian Venus, also known as Semiramis. Most faithful Catholics, historically insulated from Scripture by the Magisterium and the Inquisition, have not known this. Jeremiah 44 explains how the Israelites violated their covenant with Yahweh by praising the Queen of Heaven, and in turn lost their dignity, property, freedom, everything to the Babylonians. Scripture teaches also that the Babylonian interests have much to gain from inducing souls to praise the Queen of Heaven, and as we shall later see, their gain is divinely approved. The term Queen of Heaven appears nowhere else in the Old and in the New Testament, but in the book of Jeremiah. And exactly five times in the book of Jeremiah. Now, I have to make a little comment here, because the author writes in Jeremiah 44. But when you open up Jeremiah 44, you will see that there Queen of Heaven only appears four times. So, it is actually quite correct that in the book of Jeremiah, Queen of Heaven appears five times, but then you have to go to Jeremiah chapter 7, verse 18. There it appears for the first time. And then it appears in 44. And I'm just going to give you the links. You can look that up for yourself. I don't read whole Jeremiah book here. But the first mention of the Queen of Heaven is in Jeremiah 7, verse 18. Then you have it in Jeremiah 44, 17, 44, 18, 19, and 25. So I'm going to read anything what the author means about the significance of five mentions in one chapter of the book, but that is for the book of Jeremiah, that is not true. Now, make up your own mind about that and what you want to learn about the Queen of Heaven. Also, Mary, Astarte, Astaroth, Cybele, Venus, whatever pagan name given to Semiramis, the original pagan goddess from Babylon, from whom all other names derive. Watch my videos on Babylon mystery religion in the playlist with the same name when you want to get a more idea about this Queen of Heaven. But now Tapasaucy really makes a point about the Queen of Heaven being mentioned in Jeremiah 44 five times, which is not correct, and you can look that up for yourselves. Did Jeremiah know that Venus' celestial trail delineated 5 points, the author continues? And did the other 35 writers of the Bible's 66 books know as well? Did all these men who wrote in different languages over a period of more than 1,000 years conspire not to mention Queen of Heaven in order to preserve Jeremiah's 5 mentions, so that the link between A, the Queen of Heaven, B, the 5-pointed path of Venus, and C, the curse resulting from praising her would stand as a divine lesson for the rest of eternity? Or did it just happen that way by accident? Or, as the Bible teaches, were Jeremiah and his co-authors inspired by the author of all creation to say, and not say, things for reasons beyond their individual understanding? The great seal's eagle holds a banner in its beak inscribed E Pluribus Unum. This phrase, which appears on American coinage as well, is popularly understood to signify the melting of many people into one nation, quote, of many one, unquote, or to identify the coin as one of many identical coins. The Gnostic understanding of this phrase, however, borders on the psychedelic. According to Manly P. Hall, E Pluribus Unum refers to the ancient Bacchic rites, which he says was, quote-unquote, a forerunner to Freemasonry. Mysterious and fantastic, the Bacchic rites are built upon the following storyline. Listen close. In a time before the creation of mankind, the 12 Titans caused Bacchus, Jupiter's beautiful son, to become fascinated by his own image in a mirror. Enthralled by himself, Bacchus is seized by the Titans. They kill him, tear him to pieces, boil the pieces in water, and afterwards roast and eat them. This grieves all his loved ones, hence his name from Bacca, to weep. Now remember, weeping for Tammuz, these deities are all the same. Weeping for Tammuz you can read in the New Testament, when the women on the temple were there. Hence his name from Bacca, to weep or lament. The strewn body parts of Bacchus become the 4 elements of matter. One of Bacchus's sister, the virgin Minerva, rescues his sacred heart from the 4 elements and places it before Jupiter in heaven. From heaven, Jupiter hurls thunderbolts at his son's murderers and reduces the Titans to ashes. The rains further reduce the ashes, mingling with the 4 elements, to slime. From this evil slime, Jupiter forms mankind, a quote-unquote titanic embodiment, from which the Bacchic idea or rational soul must be released. The Bacchic idea is released by evil slime's sexual energy, especially when facilitated by alcoholic drink. Hence, Bacchus is associated with grapevines, wild dancing, phallic symbols, and fornication. You know, Bacchus is the god of wine, right? when death and sex have rescued the rational soul from the four slimy corners of the earth, a transfigured eternal Bacchus is resurrected as the flaming sun. He is a pluribus unum, one from many, a resurrection symbolized by the pentagram, the one rising out of the four to make five. This, says Manly P. Hall, is the magical formula of man. Quote, the human soul rising from the bondage of the animal nature. The pentagram is the true light, the star of the morning, marking the location of five mysterious centers of force, the awakening of which the supreme secret of white magic. Unquote. Now, white magic, black magic, all magic is the same. There is no difference between white and black magic, and all is forbidden by the Lord and an abomination to him. With a pluribus unum flowing from his beak, Jupiter's eagle preaches the Bacchic gospel. It is a gospel of salvation that antedates that of Jesus Christ by many, many centuries. The Bacchic gospel was preached and played out in the pagan cults. A holy virgin would ritually rescue the Son of God's sacred heart from the slime of humanity imprisoning the Son's soul. Each cult initiate, a fractional part of the Son's soul, supposedly gained increasing amounts of knowledge from mind-altering substances and sexual ecstasy administered for money, of course, by the temple priest and priestesses. Did you get that? Each cult initiate, a fractional part of the Sun's soul, supposedly gained increasing amounts of knowledge, gaining knowledge from mind-altering substances and sexual ecstasy administered for money. Why do you think the woman is called a whore in Revelation 17? Rome is such a sex cult because they even think that through sex they get knowledge. Okay, continuing. The initiate looked forward to being released from his slimy humanity by ever-increasing knowledge. He yearned to be reunited ultimately with the Sacred Heart in heaven, resurrected and transfigured for all eternity. I mean, they really have some strange ideas about eternal life, don't you think? When you compare that to the Bible and what is promised to us. This salvational plan, the author continues, or some variation of it, can be found at the core of all the secret or mystery religions, cults of empire. It persists from the earliest Babylonian prototype right on down through the Great Seal. It has succeeded not because it calls for repentance from sin, but because it makes sin an asset in a process of self-deification. And if we are God, that is self-deification, we do not need a Messiah to save us. Isn't that the whole preaching of the New Age? Isn't that the whole preaching of Satanism, of Luciferianism? When we are gods, we do not need a God to save us, right? That's what it's all about, self-deification. The Bacchic gospel serves an economy of sin management, in which sins are forgiven upon the payment of money or performance of some act of contrition valuable to society. It is about people control, because it prospers on the addictive nature of fornication and mind-altering substances. It naturally facilitates sex and booze and drugs and all their destructive fallout in order to have a context in which to make itself useful. Unlike the Christian gospel, which conditions forgiveness of sins upon repentance, quote, and if he repents, forgive him, as we can read in Luke 17, verse 3, the Bacchic gospel forgives upon the tendering of appropriate sacrifices to the priest of the appropriate deity. The congeniality of this gospel to secular government and Roman Catholicism speaks for itself. the congeniality of this gospel to secular government and Roman Catholicism speaks for itself. Rome is more than just a church. It's most and for all a political entity. The congeniality of this gospel to secular government and Roman Catholicism speaks for itself. A powerful sentence that F. Tapper Sorcy wrote here in this book. The reverse side of the Great Seal contains four elements. First, the motto Annuit Coeptis. Second, a 13-coursed topless pyramid with MDCCLXXVI engraved in the foundation. Third, a disembodied eye forming the pyramid's capstone. And fourth, the motto Novus Ordo Seclorum. These elements define exactly the quote-unquote divine providence upon whose protection the signers of the Declaration of Independence firmly relied. The land of the pyramid, Egypt, is where Caesarian Rome was inaugurated. By Caesarian, I mean the empire whose head commands not only affairs of state, but those of religion as well. Combination of church and state. What does the Bible say about that? It's one thing. What does the Roman Catholic Church teach about that? That's another thing. By Caesarian, I mean, the emperor says, the empire whose head commands not only affairs of state, but those of religion as well. Caesarian Rome officially began in Alexandria, Egypt, at the Temple of Jupiter on the winter solstice, December 25th. Oh, what an interesting date, huh? In the year 48 before Christ, when a 52-year-old priest of Jupiter was declared to be Jupiter's incarnation, thus, quote-unquote, son of God. His name was Caius of the family of Marius, Caius Mariae. After deification, and occasionally before, Caius Mariae was referred to as Caesar, a Kabbalism formed by the letter C, for Caius, attached to Azar, the Etruscan word for God. The god Caius. Suetonius, the first century biographer of the Caesars, suggested that the title was formed from prefixing Azar with the numeral C, meaning hundred, god of the hundred, or hundreds. Now, I'm going to read this little paragraph again because it is so fascinating. After deification and occasionally before, Caius Mariae was referred to as Caesar, a Kabbalism formed by the letter C for Caius, attached to Azar, the Etruscan word for God. The god Caius. And Suetonius, the first century biographer of the Caesar, suggested that the title was formed from prefixing Azar with the numeral C, meaning hundred, god of the hundred, or hundreds. According to Scottish theologian Alexander Hislop, author of The Two Babylons, Caesar consented to deification in order to inherit the huge kingdom of Pergamum, consisting of most of Asia Minor, present-day Turkey that is. Pergamum was bequeathed to the Roman people in 133 BC by its king, Attalus III. But there was a catch. The people of Rome had to regard their leader as God. The Pergaminian kings had begun ruling as God when the title of Pontifex Maximus fled the fall of Babylon in 539 BC. In that eventful year, Persian invaders assassinated the Babylonian king Belshazzar. Just moments prior, Belshazzar had seen his assassination prophesied by the famous handwriting on the wall, Mene, mene, tekel, upharsin, as we can read in Daniel chapter 5 in the King James Version. Mene, mene, tekel, upharsin, the numberer is numbered. Ruling as God by divine appointment, Belshazzar had profaned the sacred vessels of the Israelite temple. This was the unpardonable sin of blasphemy, for which God sent the Persians to destroy him. So you see, people don't have to rise up against an unlawful leader. God will send some way to do that, as he did here in Daniel 5, that you can read with Mene Mene Tekel Upharsin, the number is numbered. God took it into his own hands to get rid of this ungodly ruler in time. Not we. We should in peace hold to God and not take weapons again unrighteous rulers. God will judge them. That's not our job to do. Anyway, I've read for an hour now and I'm going to stop this part 1 of chapter 20, Rulers of Evil, American Graffiti, and we'll continue another day with the second part of this. Thanks for watching, and please leave your comments below in the comment section. Until next time, God bless you all and bye-bye.